lives of great men all remind us we can make our lives sublime, and departing leave behind us footprints in the sands of time. That was Jimmy Goldsmith. Some men see things as they are and ask why. I dream things that never were and ask why not. That was Jimmy Goldsmith. That best portion of a good man's life, his little nameless, unremembered acts of kindness and love. That was Jimmy Goldsmith. You cannot choose your battlefield. The gods do that for you. But you can plant a standard where a standard never flew. That was Jimmy Goldsmith. We're here today to celebrate Jimmy's life. The man who, when asked once by an opponent on the tennis court why he was wearing slippers, explained that no one in the Goldsmith family had run in 5 generations and he was not going to be the first. Which was presumably why he used to talk about standing for office in Putney and not running for it. I remember soon after Bruce Gintle arrived at TVAM to run it and so on, he said to me one day, he said, "I met your friend Jimmy Goldsmith at dinner last night." He said, "He was in great form. He held forth all evening on every subject under the sun. And I just sat and listened, but God knows what he thought of me. I mean, I don't think I uttered a word all night." And later on, I was speaking to Jimmy, and he said, "I met your friend Bruce Gintle last night. One of the most intelligent men I've ever met." That's Jimmy Goldsmith. In fact, during our celebration, we shall be hearing from Teddy Goldsmith, of course, and from Jemima, Isabel, and Alice, who've chosen special readings for this morning. We shall also be hearing from Dr. Henry Kissinger and Baroness Thatcher, who will have to leave partway through the service to attend the memorial service for Lord Tony Pandy, which is also taking place today. Appropriately enough, a man whom Jimmy both admired and liked. This service, because Jimmy was not a churchgoer, this service is taking place in what is now a secular building. So if you see numbers on the wall, it's not the list of the hymns, it's the Hang Seng Index. Jimmy was not religious, but he was spiritual. There was an inner flame, a fire within him that shimmered and sparkled and ignited his own unique set of values, dreams, and ideas. He was a seer, a prophet, a reformer, willful, impulsive, hot-headed, warm-hearted, generous to a fault, especially with his own. A slayer of sacred cows, a towering leader, a faithful friend, a radical thinker, an unconventional husband, but always a devoted family man and a proud and loving father. And what a way he had with words. One example, you remember, he wrote, "The epitaph on our society may well be, they sacrifice the long term for the short term, and the long term finally caught up with them." The way he expressed himself, that's just one reason why death is not a full stop. It's just a comma in the story of Jimmy Goldsmith's ideas. And in any case, as Thomas Campbell wrote, "To live in the hearts we leave is not to die." Jimmy Goldsmith is very much alive in our hearts and our thoughts this morning. So, let's celebrate.
Thank you. Goldsmith, whose memory we celebrate today, was a giant among men. He was great in his qualities and great in his impact. No one whose life he touched remained unchanged. No walk of life he trod failed to bear his imprint. I knew of Jimmy long before I actually got to know him. His name in those days was virtually synonymous with a buccaneering capitalism that elicited no end of tut-tutting at the time. I never felt tempted to join the chorus, for capitalism, remember, depends upon the challenge of competition, not the complacency of corporatism. And without the Goldsmiths, who make capital work to maximize profit, millions of shareholders and pension fund investors would be the poorer. But in any case, Jimmy's business activities received a mixed press. Indeed, a mixed press, or perhaps more accurately, mixing it with the press, became one of Jimmy's stock in trade. That was all an excellent preparation for his eruption into political life. Jimmy brought to bear on politics the same intellectual clarity that had stood him so well in business. He immediately distinguished between ends and means. He saw through at once the clouds of obfuscation that easily befuddle so many of the not-so-bright professionals. For as the poet put it, all the world would keep a matter hid, since truth is seldom friend to any crowd. But Jimmy was never part of the crowd. He understood the issues that were truly at stake. He learned fast. He could puncture sloppy interviewers and demolish opponents with a special blend of ferocity and polish. The measure of his success was a fear he inspired in the political bureaucratic class that opposed him. It had much of the desired effect. Before ever a vote was cast at the last election, Jimmy's initiative had dragged both main parties to concede the referendum they had earlier refused. Jimmy was certainly one of the bravest men I ever met. Bravery comes in many shapes and forms. Aristotle, I think, observed that a woman's bravery is different from a man's. And I would supplement the philosopher by saying that physical and moral courage are also quite different from each other and don't always go together. But in Jimmy, they did. It takes guts to start up a political party, no matter how rich you are. It takes courage of a high order to lay yourself open to the taunts and sneers of lesser men who try to diminish your character because they can't defeat your arguments. And it takes a well-nigh superhuman brand of bravery to do all these, as Jimmy did this spring, knowing you're mortally ill, feeling your strength ebbing, fighting back the pain without a shred of self-pity or complaint. Jimmy was a fighter, and he fought to win. But he fought like the legendary crusader, whose chivalry is as great as his cause is true. You never met a more generous man. The generosity could be epic, as with the referendum party and his support for environmental issues. Or it could be quiet and personal, as it was to those in need. There was not an ounce of side or a gram of snobbery in him. He took people as he found them. It didn't matter whether he were a mogul of British industry or a solid French peasant, in whose good sense he expressed considerable confidence. It didn't even matter if you were a former prime minister. He valued a man or woman for their qualities, ideas, and deeds, not for their reputation or connections. Although our paths had crossed before, it was only recently that we became friends. It was a friendship based, of course, on largely shared convictions, but it was cemented by conversation. It has sometimes been said that I can be loquacious. As a now defunct television quiz program has it, I've started, so I'll finish. But Jimmy Goldsmith was a no less unstoppable talker. I still seem to see those piercing bright blue eyes, hands jabbing the air to make a myriad points, to hear that flow of sparkling, persuasive exposition, punctuated by anecdote, lightened by repartee, that never seemed to dry up. And nearly always, he was right. He'd looked at the facts, he'd heard the argument, weighed the evidence, and deduced in a pellucid way that rarely clever men do, a truth so obvious that you wonder why you hadn't thought of it first. Above all, he was right about Europe, the word upon which hang so many questions fundamental to our national identity and future. Being the man he was, Jimmy couldn't settle for just one patriotism. He had to have two, one for each of his beloved France, and I like to think his still more beloved Britain. His family roots, the range of his business interests, the circles in which he moved, his felicity for languages, his breadth of taste, all made him a true European. I think this explains in part why the Eurocrats so resented him. His whole persona was a kind of living demonstration that you don't need to lose your own identity to appreciate someone else's. He was a great European on a continent in which the little Europeans claimed as their own. You had only to visit that extraordinary chateau in Burgundy with its magnificent library to understand that the discerning owner's mind was attuned to that glorious European cultural achievement, which some are keen to reduce to a mere political slogan. In life, Jimmy Goldsmith was a man to whom only superlatives do justice. But in the face of death, even the superlatives fall silent. I'm not sure what Jimmy ultimately believed in, but one of his strongest penultimate beliefs was in the loyalties of friendship. To be a friend of Jimmy's was to know that someone, somewhere, would always stick by you, whatever the cost. He would have been pleased to know that so many of his friends, who knew him better and longer than I did, had met here to remember him. I, for one, shall never forget this magnificent warrior for truth, this great-hearted patriot, whom for all too short a season, I was privileged to call a friend.
Thank you. When my family was about to leave the country of my birth, I called on my grandfather, to whom I was very attached, in the little village where he lived, to say goodbye. He was suffering from cancer, and I knew I would never see him again. My grandfather took the finality out of the encounter by telling me that we were not really parting, because he would pay me a final visit at my parents' home a few weeks hence. Though I did not believe it, the prospect proved remarkably consoling. In the forlorn final months of Jimmy's life, when I knew but did not accept that the end was near, my conversations with Jim had a similar character. We talked on the telephone almost every day. From the public description of his illness, the prognosis was all too inevitable. Yet, Jimmy did not address me as if his fate were foreordained. The decline in the force of his voice, described by John Aspinall in his moving article, was hidden by what I now know was a staggering effort of will. Jimmy spoke to me with seemingly undiminished power of his plans for recovery. He was gaining strength, he would say. He was looking forward to the day when he could receive me appropriately, as if the obstacle to our meeting were some technical impediment. He even set a tentative date of July 7th, a few weeks hence. Though we would be talking on the phone, on July 5th, he sent me a note whose formality suggested that another temporary obstacle had intervened, but which implied that a new date would be set soon for the occasion when he could give me a proper welcome. Only the shaky signature showed Jimmy's travail. Throughout, Jimmy put the prospects of recovery in a gambler's framework. He rated his chances without treatment as 1 in 150. The treatment he was undergoing surely would raise the odds. But of course, for those of us who knew Jimmy, odds of 1 in 150 seemed quite surmountable. Only on July 13th, when Jimmy uttered his first and only admission of the agony he was undergoing by saying, "It is getting tough," did I know that it would soon be over. Basically, Jimmy did not want to discuss his physical condition. What he talked about, even at the end, were his political preoccupations. He had come up with some ideas how to preserve the historical core of the European nations if the plan for a single currency moved towards conclusion, as it seemed to be doing. Since he knew that I would be meeting several European public figures, he suggested that I try these ideas out on them. And then he grilled me afterwards about their reaction and gave me a little tutorial about some of the complicated economic aspects that seemed to be beyond me. I had become close to Jimmy only in the last 6 years of his life. Before then, he had exploded in and out of my life at irregular intervals, sometimes with some financial advice, which I rarely took, to my invariable disadvantage, and more frequently with some passionate commentary on the contemporary scene. Luckily for me, Nancy persuaded me to spend some days in Cook's Marlow, where almost magically, Jimmy and I became friends. True friendship is a rare blessing at any stage of one's life, and a near miracle when it happens at the age both of us had reached by then. I realize that there were many aspects of Jimmy's life shared by others in this room, which I did not. But in whatever incarnation, Jimmy was out of scale, passionate, brilliant, very brave, charming, and always lots of fun. After my then 95-year-old mother met him, she described him as the most intelligent and charming person she had ever met. The most intelligent, I asked, grasping for reassurance. The most, she insisted. The Jimmy Goldsmith I came to know as a friend was quite different from the public persona. Gentle, infinitely thoughtful, always available, never intrusive. Since Jimmy was of the view that high finance was not my best subject, we talked mostly about the political world, which I believe to have been his central concern anyway. To him, business was a game which he played marvelously well. But his passionate commitment was evoked by his near despair about the drift of our civilization. Near despair, for Jimmy, of course, implied neither passive contemplation nor self-indulgent resignation. It was a summons to battle, to which he devoted what he knew, but no one else did, the last years of his life. To Jimmy, Western civilization mattered. He reveled in its celebration of the dignity of the individual, its elaboration of a concept of justice based on values not defined by the state. All this, in his view, was being threatened by fashionable sociological doctrines undermining societies whose delicate fabric had evolved over the century, and by bureaucrats, applying without love and without hatred self-righteous concepts of world improvement. Jimmy's sense of justice involved him in struggles in distant corners of the globe. And of course, he cared deeply about the preservation of the environment, which is our common legacy. Occasionally, I tease Jimmy that politics might not be his best subject. But Jimmy was not a politician, nor a businessman, much less a self-flagellating world improver. I think of Jimmy as a knight errant from a medieval romance, alighting from his castle to do battle with dragons and monsters from which the faint-hearted have fled, and protecting even those who did not know they needed protection. The epic hero does not define himself by conventional wisdom, but by the perils he braves, the exertions he evokes, and the perceptions he personifies. Jimmy was Don Quixote with a bit of Sancho Panza, at once inspiring and practical, visionary and analytical. None of us who loved Jimmy can quite accept that this huge, life-enhancing force is no longer with us. But the void he has left is our badge of honor. We would not trade places with those who did not have the good fortune to have their lives ennobled by contact with our fallen friend.
Thank you. Do not stand at my grave and weep. I am not there. I do not sleep. I am a thousand winds that blow. I am the softly falling snow. I am the gentle rains that fall. I am the fields of ripening grain. I am in the morning hush. I am in the graceful rush of beautiful birds encircling flight. I am the starshine of the night. I am in the flowers of bloom. I am in a quiet room. I am in the birds that sing. I am in each lovely thing. Do not stand at my grave and die. Sorry, and cry. I did not.
I've chosen to read this poem because for me it represents the way that my father chose to lead his life and the way that through his example he encouraged his children and others to lead their lives too. To laugh is to risk appearing a fool. To cry is to risk appearing sentimental and soft. To reach out to another is to risk involvement. To show up and expose your feelings is to risk exposing your inherent self. To place your ideas, your dreams, your desires before people is to risk their loss. To love is to risk you might not be loved in return. To live is to risk dying. To show strength is to risk showing weakness. To do is to risk failure. But the greatest hazard in life is to risk nothing. The person who risks nothing, gets nothing, has nothing, is nothing. He may avoid suffering, pain, sorrow, but he does not learn. He does not grow. He does not live, he does not love. He has sold, forfeited freedom, integrity. He is a slave, chained by safety, locked away by fear. Because only a person who is willing to risk not knowing the result is truly free.
Yo sé bien que
I decided to read a beautiful poem written by one of Daddy's closest friends and collaborators in Paris. It'll be written by Claude-Henri Lecomte. Therefore, excuse me, it will be written in French. Jimmy le Feu, Jimmy le Tendre, la mort ne te ressemble pas. Il te fallait encore attendre plus longtemps que sonne le glas. Quoi, le destin analphabète n'a pas su lire dans les yeux qui confondaient crime et conquête en te volant tes jours heureux. Heureux, heureux, façon de dire, ta puissance de création ne bâtissait pas ton empire sans douleur, sans immolation. Toujours ton âme téméraire visa l'universalité et les peintures, les sculptures, la bourse et ses littératures, les remèdes et leur nature, les cuisiniers et leurs fritures, les cavaliers et leurs montures, l'Europe et ses longues fêlures, le monde et ses déconfitures. Tout fut jugé, pesé, compté, compté par toi, prince du nombre. Maintenant, nous pleurons dans l'ombre, l'éclat brisé de tes vertus, et nous voyons qu'il fait très sombre, papa, quand tu n'es plus. Opposant tes savants regards à cet univers interlope, pourquoi nous laisses-tu à gare avant d'avoir sauvé l'Europe? Ton délire en sa vérité nous aura révélé le piège où peut glisser l'humanité que l'armée des erreurs assiège. Jimmy, nous te pleurons, Jimmy, sous un soleil gorgé de voiles, mais ton absence est une nuit dont nous garderons les étoiles.
Thank you. This is really, for me, a mixture of a joyous occasion and a sad occasion. Jimmy was my closest friend, and he was the only person who ever inhibited me from speaking my mind at any meeting. The only two occasions in my life that I ever wrote a speech or ever read a speech or under his instructions. One was at Brighton, where there were 5,000 of his supporters, and the other was in Alexander Park, where there were 12,000 of his supporters. And he knew me to be an incontinent speaker. He knew perfectly well my failings as an orator, that I could easily go over the top on any subject that intrigued me or interested me. So he would had to submit my speech to him, like a cabinet minister to the prime minister. And then he used to amend it together over the telephone. And then he would say, "Stick to the text, Aspers, please." And it's difficult for me because on the first occasion in Brighton, there were 5,000 of his supporters. The trouble was I lost my way. I've never read a speech. I'm terribly bad at reading. I have some notes here, which as a sort of help me for me in case I lose my way. But the idea of reading a speech was alien to my nature. I'd never done it before. So if you actually read something, you lose your way. You're worse off than if you just lack words at a certain moment in the speech. However, other than that particular lapse, it went quite well. And then at an even more important occasion for us all in the referendum party and for a number of people here, there was another meeting in Alexandra Park with 12 or 14,000 people. And I had to submit my speech again to him. We discussed on the telephone and also discussed his speeches often with him. And well, he was very happy with it. And I read that out. But I must confess that I'm very pleased in one sense only that he's not here right now, because I can speak my mind and tell you what I think without that powerful personality. He was the only man to whom I ever conceded superiority there over me. The only man, let alone a woman, that I would ever concede any superiority to in my life was Jimmy. And that's the greatest compliment that I can ever pay him. Because from when first I met him, and he's 17. Even then, though I was 6 years older than him, I regarded him as an equal at 17. And I kept this parity for a number of years. 10 or 15 years we had a parity, because we had a parity of poverty as well, which kept us together. It was only when he sailed into his great fortune and sailed into an arena where I couldn't really respond that he left me, and I had to concede that element of fear of one man for another. And he certainly, I was always wary of him. And I have to tell you, he was frightened of me. He was frightened of what I would say, because anything I said was associated with him. So I frightened him more than he frightened me. But anyway, I've not really come here to make you laugh. Though this is a joyous occasion, this is a celebration of Jimmy's memory and his achievements and his personality and his honor. It's a celebration of his greatness, and it's meant to be joyous. And I'm glad to see that many people understand this. It's not a religious occasion, though towards the end of his life, I have to tell you that he became almost spiritual. The only spirituality that I really ever saw in him was towards the end of his life, and it was nothing to do with a conventional religion. It was a reverence for the natural world, and a reverence for what exists and what the earth was meant to be. So, well, I've already haven't looked at it. You see, I have this in front of me to make me feel confident. So I have to look at it from time to time. No, on this occasion, I'm free to speak without Jimmy bothering me. Now, we've had some distinguished speakers, and Lady Thatcher said to me 2 or 3 months before Jimmy died in South Africa, she came to tea, I think it was, or lunch, And she said to me, four words, Jimmy is a genius. I pass it on because it's a compliment from a woman not entirely without distinction herself. 10 years ago, I bumped into Henry Kissinger in the Kennedy Airport Concorde Lounge with a friend of mine who is with us here. I won't mention his name. And we talked, and either he'd been staying with Jimmy or we had been staying with Jimmy. I can't remember, it was 10 years ago. But what sticks in my mind is an expression of his 10 years ago. He said, Jimmy, has the greatest brain, the greatest wisdom of anyone I've ever known. I could give you a rendition of Henry Kissinger's voice, but I shall keep that for after dinner tonight. And that he should draw so high a compliment from someone in Dr. Kissinger's position didn't surprise me, but my assessment of him went up sky high, that he had the percipience to understand that he had been speaking and was becoming a friend of a great genius. And I use that word without hesitation. For me, of course, you can't expect an objective appraisal or a detached assessment, because far from being detached from Jimmy, I was attached to him, and far from being objective, I've never been objective about anything, least of all from Jimmy Goldsmith. It's a subjective friendship that we have, based on affection and a mutual transfer of admiration. And also, don't expect too short a speech from me. I hope I don't keep you too long, but I can't get through this very quickly. Jimmy's fiery spirit, we all know of, was drawn from the alembic of his mother. It poured from his mother. Marcel had amazing energy, and that's where it originated. And it was this energy from his mother that fueled his brain, that fired his passions, and in some strange alchemy, turned his blood into the ichor of a genius. Because through his blood, through his blood, flowed this passionate, incredible fluid. I met him at Oxford 6 months to 9 months after I met his elder brother, Teddy. And he'd left Eton with a pile of cash, £800 or something, which in those days was an enormous amount of money. And I met him, and from the very moment I met him, I knew I was in the presence of an extraordinary man. Almost preternatural, his impression on me at those early days. In the first blush of his manhood, if you like, he must have been 15, no, 17, 17. Maybe he wasn't even 17. He just left Eton, came to Oxford where his brother was. I met him, and within two or three days, by some strange and deep biology, we were friends. Somebody used to say, I remember reading about us even then in the paper, the magazine, that it was the Goth and the Babylonian. I was obviously the Goth, Germanic, blonde, fierce, young, powerful, strong, and insensitive. And there was Goldsmith. Babylonian is a far description of him. But I can understand that he was this amazing looking man of 17, so powerful of personality. I had always a problem of keeping parity with him, in spite of the 6 year age difference. He had, of course, a star quality even then. But not everybody saw it. There are two or three people in this audience from those days who knew him as I knew him and have subsequently said to me, much later in their very distinguished careers, Aspers, you saw him, we never saw him. The other person who saw him and who knew him better than I did was his brother, Teddy, with whom I was already a great friend. And we would discuss alone this phenomenon of a younger brother. We would discuss him alone, decided then that Jimmy was a genius. that the strange mystery of the genes is ancestors on both sides that coalesced to produce this preternatural figure. So that's how we saw him. Jimmy had no interest, believe it or not, in posthumous fame. Unlike me, I come from 10,000 years of Magna Germanic ancestors who believe in posthumous fame, because it was only through an oral culture that one's fame could persist at all for a few generations. But he had, it surprised me this, he appeared to have no interest in it. And this was reflected later on in life when he got to know famous men like President Nixon and Reagan, some of the speakers here, and others too numerous to mention. You know, he had all his correspondence from them shredded. Either he was so confident of his own posthumous fame, or he didn't care. Curiously enough, nobody, few, could read him or read him as well as I did. I don't think he cared what posterity thought of him, unlike myself. But I'm not sure. He used to, for instance, shred letters from famous men and women. He shred them. I mean, I don't get very many letters from famous men or women, but I tell my secretary, put them away somewhere. Someday somebody will write my life, I hope. And they'll look around and say, oh yes, he had a letter from so-and-so or so-and-so. Jimmy never cared. His self-confidence was so extraordinary. According to his brother here, Teddy, from the age of six, that he never bothered with posthumous fame. My self-confidence is so limited, I think of little else. Now, I'm saying he shredded letters from President Nixon, President Reagan, and numerous other people. He was extraordinary in that way. And I rather just didn't much go along with that, although I had any say in what he shredded. But I thought it's far better that he keeps these things. It wasn't that he didn't have a sense of history. He did. Now, one of the things about Jimmy was that all his successes were on his own terms. Entirely on his own terms. And when he was young, entirely on his own terms. Once he'd left the fading authority of his parents, once he'd walked away from all his schools, including Eton, in midterm, because he won a large bet on three horses, and trebles and doubles, and came up to Oxford and joined us. Everything in life that I ever knew him do, he did on his own terms. The only curb on Jimmy Goldsmith was not public opinion, it wasn't what the press might think, it wasn't how the editorials might be, it was merely the only curb on him was his own sense of quality or decency, his own value structure, himself internally constructed and made. Was the only curb on him was himself. He knew no other curbs, and certainly later on in life. He was strangely unfit for any structural hierarchy. From the 17, Jimmy had no one in authority over him ever. He ran his own little companies, most of which went bust, or if they didn't go bust, they didn't succeed very well. There was never a curb on him. He did what he wanted, when he wanted, and why he wanted it. In that sense, he was a free man. He was completely removed from structural hierarchies. And he often said to me, Asperger's, because I had a similar nature, but he said, Asperger's, you know, he said, I haven't a choice. I can't concur. I can't become part of a hierarchy. I couldn't become a member of parliament. I couldn't join Unilever. He said, Aspers, it's impossible for me. I either go bust, and I get disgraced, or I make a fortune. He said, what alternative is there for any man? I said, well, I can understand this fully, Jimmy, because I'm in the same position as you. I can't submit to hierarchies either. I can't take orders. Jimmy was his own master from the age, really, I suppose. He was rebelling against whatever authority there was. At 17, he hit freedom in Oxford. And from that, except for a short session in the army And the stories there are so extraordinary that I haven't got time to tell you. But he was unfit for hierarchies. He never accepted, by the way, any general assumption. Didn't matter if millions, tens of millions, or billions of people, humans, agreed with something or did something. It didn't impress him at all. He shared some assumptions with people. Naturally, he shared a number of assumptions that we all have. But he would not believe, he did not believe in the validity of any assumption unless he himself had tested it, or unless, more important, he himself felt it. Feeling was what guided him. People followed him, of course, from a sense of adventure and excitement that he himself generated. I remember in the early days, his takeover bids for Carr's biscuits, or Carson's chocolates, or Singleton and Curl, I could give you a list, but everything was incredible excitement. His followers, there weren't very many, and his investors, there weren't very many either, had a feeling that they were onto something exciting. He managed to generate excitement from within himself. I mean, nothing particularly glamorous about Carr's biscuits, but he managed to make the whole thing an anabasis and excitement and adventure. People followed him for a sense of adventure. Speak to the people who used to work for Jimmy. They followed him for adventure and excitement. They had around him this aura of excitement, with that faint lack of control which gave an added spice to his nature. He had, of course, a capacity from the very beginning of his life for the ignition of excitement. To be with him was exciting. To think he was arriving was exciting. I may just be speaking for myself, but I have a feeling I'm not. From within, to paraphrase Walter Pater, he burned always with a gem-like flame. When he was deeply moved, the flame flared dangerously. And there were few men more dangerous than Jimmy, if in this mood. When that flame spluttered, people had to take care. But when he was calm, the inner fire glowed softly, silently, and warmly. But that inner fire was always with him. The window of his soul were his eyes. The luster shone from within. His ambition shone. His emotion shone. He was an emotional man. His eyes were like Greek fire. And even when he was relaxed, you could never be sure of his eyes. Above all, Jimmy liked a battle. He liked a struggle. He had certain qualities: audacity, financial and intellectual daring, and brilliancy, and political vision. Jimmy was an inspirational leader. He led from in front, prepared to take everything that was thrown at him. He went into situations from which it was hard to find a gain. He was undeterred by being unpopular or even hated. I think it inspired him if enough people hated him, particularly certain people. He could bear a grudge, and did, but he never forgot a kindness. And he believed that it was almost impossible the people who are unable to bear a grudge, to forget a kindness. The media had certainly at one time, almost to a man, reviled him, vilified him, and attempted to ridicule him. I reminded him in one of these occasions when an evening paper here had written an article so appalling, personal level, political level, every level you can think of. He was in Paris, and I used to fax him these articles, and I thought twice about it. It's a negative and unattractive thing. And I knew his physical condition, and I wasn't sure. But then, of course, I did, because he would want it to have known. I mean, it was astounding how certain elements in both television and the newspapers hated him and feared him. He liked being feared, of course. But I remember I reminded once of a letter that Cicero wrote to his brother Quintus, when Quintus was in Asia Minor. And in this letter to his brother, Cicero said, it is one of the tragedies. It's one of the tragedies of life. He said that a man is hated for his good deeds. And Jimmy's deeds were intended to save, I won't say improve the standard of living of the human race, but to save it from destruction. He had the widest conceivable ambitions. I mean, if you look at his life, what finer action can there be when you know you're going to die in 3 or 4 months' time? You start political campaigns. What for? He wouldn't be there to see any successes. Merely because he had an affection for the English nation and the French nation. He loved Europe. He was a pure European. Few today question his political vision. If you only got to look at last Sunday's newspapers, the Sunday Times and the Sunday Telegraph, both had leading editorials. And it's clear from them, one editorial was sleepwalking into Europe, that was the Sunday Times, and it could have been written by Jimmy, and it couldn't have been published 6 months ago. It was exactly, in fact, it was Jimmy's expression that they borrowed from him. Of course, they never gave him recognition for it, nor would he have expected it. The Sunday Telegraph wrote nearly the whole of its editorial column on why we fought. I started to read this, hoping it was going to be as I expected it, and it was even better. Halfway through, there was a caption. He said, Germany's third attempt this century to control Europe. That could have been written. It couldn't have been published 6 months ago. It was only due to Jimmy's courage and fortitude that these articles are now being printed. And his vision. He had political vision. He had no political ambitions other than that his ideas should survive. Just like he was no interest in posthumous fame, he wanted his ideas and what he thought to survive him. 6 months ago, as I say, these editorials would have been impossible to publish, even from those newspapers. I suppose, to sum up Jimmy in a phrase, you could say he was fiery in his temper, fierce in his loyalties, ardent of soul, zealous of principle, his principle, and protective of his precepts, his family, his followers, and his friends. A remarkable man has left us, a man the like of which, of course, we won't see again, any more than we've seen anyone like him, other than himself, in his lifetime. His contribution, history will decide it. As I say, his posthumous fame, if it is to survive, is dependent on, to some degree, on the people here, his family, his friends, the people who admired him and loved him. It's up to us, it's incumbent upon us to see that his memory lasts. Maybe he won't need us, such is his contribution, and so history as it unfolds before us in the future, I'm sure, will validate his opinions that some have thought eccentric, or some have thought extraordinary, or some have thought redundant. Incidentally, I wouldn't for a moment suggest that Jimmy Goldsmith didn't do everything in his life that he wanted. He was the most superbly selfish man. There was nothing he did that he didn't enjoy doing, except before he had private planes as a young man hanging around in airports, things like that. He did, his life was a self-indulgence of a genius. But fortunately for some, fortunately, his indulgences coincide with deep human needs and desires. And in that way, I think he'll be remembered. And in that way, will posterity remember him. Thank you very much.
was very moved by the four talks I've heard already today. I wonder what I have to add. They have really understood Jimmy. I recognized him in all those talks. John Aspinall perhaps knew him better than anybody else. I possibly knew him the longest. In fact, I saw him the first time the morning he was born, on the 26th of February, 1933, in Paris. He was a great disappointment to me. You see, France has three great heroes. Vercingetorix, who fought so valiantly against Julius Caesar, Joan of Arc, and Napoleon. I had a great friend, my only real buddy, called Antoine, with whom I played every day in the Bois de Boulogne. He was Vercingetorix, and I was Napoleon. We badly needed a Joan of Arc. And our mother, dad, produced a little boy. Well, you heard about Jimmy and his incredible power of dominating people. He was the most dominant figure I have ever met. And I don't have to tell you that I didn't take me long to realize that I wasn't going to be Napoleon for long. It lasted until he could walk and talk, not much longer than that. I don't think I've ever seen or known anybody that Jimmy did not dominate, or any group of people. I remember distinctly when he was about 23 years old. I was in business with him. I worked for him. He's one of the few people who were sufficiently philanthropic to employ me. Not for long, I might add. And I remember him confronting a group of very important but extremely nervous French bankers to whom he owed enormous sums of money. But within a short while, he completely dominated them. These people were very much more frightened of him than they were of losing their cash. And they left the room, having lent him still more money. I couldn't believe my eyes, but then Jimmy, though we knew him well, he'd be beautifully described today, was such a complex character that he never ceased to amaze me. I just looked at him then, I couldn't believe my eyes, and he's never ceased to amaze me ever since. Jimmy has often been accused of being a megalomaniac. I suppose that's true, but only in the sense that for him, no problem was too big for him to try and solve. No enemy was too powerful for him to do battle with him. In fact, Jimmy liked battles. He loved battles. He lived, in fact, in a permanent state of siege. I remember telling him that he should have been a general. But his fairly predictable answer was, yes, that's a good idea, but how would I have managed peacetime? What would I have done when there wasn't a war? Of course, he had also far-reaching ambitions. It's been said today that his business career, his incredibly brilliant business career, was not something he did for the sake of it. He always wanted to make a fortune since he was a child. Since I can remember him, he always wanted to make a huge fortune. That was his first goal. He started, as Aspas told you, when he was six. And the first big deal he did was with me. We both collected seashells in Nassau, the Bahamas, where we were during the war. We collected stamps. He persuaded me to part with my stamp collection for his shell collection. I don't have to tell you, he did pretty well out of that. But his ambition was, as I said, far-reaching. He's always wanted to be a politician, and I think those who knew him well realized that. He wanted, the fortune he was going to make would give him the power and the influence that he needed. Not again, not just for its own sake. He wanted this power and this influence also because he wanted to change many things. And if he'd lived another 5 or 6 years, he could have changed the world. Again, Jimmy was, as has been said today, was a man of astonishing brilliance. I've been a sort of marginal, part-time academic, and I've never met anybody in academia with a brain that could compare to his. Never. I mean, the people I've met in that world are intellectual dwarfs compared to him. He had enormous vision. He was a thinker, too. In fact, a very deep thinker on industrial society in which we lived. For instance, and here, of course, I come to his environmental interests. The environmental havoc wrought by our industrial society is generally considered to be little more than the price we have to pay for progress. He rethought that one out too, and he rejected that assumption. He realized that we couldn't continue destroying our environment without threatening our very survival on this planet. Of course, I'm usually credited with having converted Jimmy to the environmental cause. It's not exactly true. I may have had a small influence on him, and even that I'm not sure about. He understood these issues way back. In 1972, for instance, he set up a foundation called the Ecological Foundation. It still exists. He gave a dinner for leading businessmen, bankers at the Ritz Hotel, addressed by Aurelio Peccei and Alexander King, the two founders of the Club of Rome. Some people here may have attended that dinner. He always realized, too, that many of our industrial activities are quite intolerable, in particular our nuclear activities. And he provided, in 1977, most of the funding for the opposition to the Thorpe project, I don't know, this retreatment plant that was to be built to handle high-level nuclear waste from the second-generation nuclear power stations. He funded the opposition to that, and that's already 20 years ago. I could go on like this. He fully understood these problems. But at the time, his priorities were different. He still had to build up his business empire. His interests were still in the business world. These issues, which he fully understood and whose gravity he realized, were still secondary to him. It's, of course, maybe 10 years ago, that he's entered this world, and he's entered this world now with a vengeance. Of course, he's entered it. He's entered it within the context of the European Parliament. He has a group of 19 MPs, which he's president. And some of these MPs are here with us today. There he opposed legislation allowing the patenting of living things. He opposed valiantly the import of beef from an America containing hormones. He opposed all the efforts of various governments to destroy the small farmers on the grounds that they are uneconomic. He fully understood, of course, that nothing was less economic and nothing was more antisocial than to destroy the small farming community. Uneconomic, of course, because our economists work on fragmentary knowledge. They don't take into account the terrible social costs of destroying the small farming community. What do you do with the peasants when you push them off the land? You've got to build houses for them, sewage works, prisons, you've got to provide them with unemployment benefits. You destroy their society, in a very short time they'll be living like us in big cities, and they lose their culture, which is basically the culture of our different societies in Europe. He understood all this, and he fought valiantly to prevent the further destruction of the French peasantry and other peasantries, by the way. He dealt with them, too, via the Goldsmith Foundation, which he set up 10 years ago, and which funds projects that contribute to the battle against the nuclear industry, industrial agriculture, the Maastricht Treaty, and free trade at a global level. Jimmy, as Aspas and others have pointed out, fought these battles with the most astonishing courage, single-mindedness, and passion, one might even say fanaticism. Typical were the way he fought the campaign to prevent the development of an important wetlands near his property in Mexico, and adjoining the ecological reserve of 30,000 acres that he'd set up with a local university. He fought this thing tooth and nail, got every environmental group in Mexico and hundreds outside it to immobilize him, to help. And he presented a petition to the president of Mexico, signed by President Carter, by Mr. Reagan, by Mrs. Thatcher, by Baroness Thatcher, and by Mr. Harold Wilson, and also Mr. Kissinger. Perhaps his most courageous and most passionate battle was against Maastricht and the proposed creation of the European superstate. It's about this, perhaps, that he felt most strongly. We all know how he said about it in England. What few people know, however, is that when he started the referendum party, he was already under a sentence of death. He'd been told nearly a year before, no, a few months before I think it was, that he had a 5% chance of living 1 year and a 0% chance of living two. It's quite astonishing how this did not deter him in any way from starting this party and fighting a really courageous and splendid campaign which put Maastricht on the map in British political circles and among the public at large, and completely changed the political climate. But it was not just in the UK that he fought this battle. We must realize that the party he set up in France, which obtained 13% of the votes at the European election, he was just a whisker behind Mr. Mitterrand, was an anti-Maastricht party, contrary to what the press tells us. Its whole goal was to prevent Maastricht. It was not anti-European, it was pro-European, in the sense that Europe is a mosaic of different cultures, and that each with its own architecture, its own food, its own customs, its own traditions, and that's how he felt it should remain. Well, he fought this battle, and he in there, but he fought it in other countries as well. Something has collapsed here. He fought it in Finland. He spread the word in Denmark, Norway, Sweden, Portugal, even in Poland, a country where there's still an enormous peasantry. Big farms don't yet exist, as I understand it. And he's certainly the only foreigner they'd ever seen who actually went there and told them that they should preserve their small farms and totally resist all efforts to industrialize their agriculture. They were amazed by his words, absolutely amazed, and they loved him. But it's often asked, of course, and John Aspinall asked it a few minutes ago, or perhaps I've probably spoken too long, but 15 minutes ago, Where did he get this astonishing persistence, this amazing courage and determination, indeed single-mindedness, you might say, fanaticism from? And he said he got it from my mother, our mother, Marcel. And he was exactly right. My mother was just as persistent as him. She was just as determined as him. But her fanaticism was geared to something quite different, something rather unexpected. Just after the war, a French deputy or MP called Marthe Richard closed down France's legendary brothels. For our mother, the brothels, with her highly professional inmates, served admirably to satisfy the lust of potential rapists and sex maniacs of all different hues. Once closed, she thought, no girl would be safe in the streets of Paris. Marthe Richard was, for my mother, a Jacques Santerre, Leon Britton, and Helmut Kohl, all rolled into one. And she fought her handiwork in the most, desperately. Endless letters she wrote to the Figaro. And in the evening, in the Boulevard des Capucines, when the police tried to catch all the prostitutes on the pavement, she'd suddenly appear with her car, with doors wide open. The prostitutes would pour into the car. And she'd tear off, grinding her teeth, driving like a maniac, weaving through narrow streets, hotly pursued by the police. And I might add, they very nearly caught her. Of course, what few people know here in England too is the incredible efforts, the amazing campaign he waged against the global economy. In America in particular, he spent a fortune in trying to stop the ratification of the GATT agreements by the American Congress. Ralph Nader, the famous consumer advocate, and Senator Weishfala, present American ambassador to Saudi Arabia, who's in this room here with us today, organized various meetings with him, advertisements in all the papers, and on two occasions he met about 100 different congressmen and their staff members. I think I'd like to give a quote, one of the things he said to them, which shows exactly what he felt about the global economy. If you ratify this treaty, he warned them, no body of men in human history will have created so much poverty, misery, and destitution as you will have done. And who are the beneficiaries? I might add, the sole beneficiaries. The answer is the super rich, people like myself. And what good is it going to do me to earn a bit more money when I'll be surrounded by desperate, half-starved people screaming for my blood? I feel like someone who's been dealt a winning hand at poker when sailing on the Titanic. That's quite a good quote, I might say. It's astonishing how few people have understood this, or perhaps how few people care about this. Jimmy, of course, cared. He cared enormously. And that leads us to think, it makes me think precisely what he would in fact have achieved if he'd been given another 10 years of life. Of course, he wasn't. He was robbed of what could have been the sweetest victories of his life. Victories that might well have been within his grasp if he had been allowed to live a little longer. To the members of his family, of course, he's still very much with us. None of them must have had a religious education. But I think that man is naturally religious. We are all naturally religious, and Jimmy, as John Aspinall told you, felt very much more strongly about this in the latter, in his last, I'd even go to say 10 years, not just since he's been ill. He realized too that it's human, it's normal, it's natural to feel that those that we loved and admired are still with us once they are dead. We may know that they are dead, but we don't necessarily believe what we know. His presence is still with all of us, and there are few things that we do without asking, what would Jimmy have thought about this? We had a meeting in Paris with his family members last week, and we decided there that we would pursue the work he undertook to the best of our abilities. I think that we have no choice. Needless to say, our efforts and our achievements will be paltry, if not pathetic, in comparison to what his would have been if he had lived. But that mustn't deter us, because none of us think that there's a greater monument that we can build to his memory than by pursuing his work. Thank you very much.
I'm glad to say that Chief Buthelezi has managed to come here and avoid a lot of his commitments to say a few words about Jimmy. He introduced me to Chief Buthelezi 7 or 8, 9 years ago, and I'm very pleased to say he's here and he'd like to say a few words about him.
Sholoza. When we are Malika,
when we are Malika, when
we are Malika,
when we are Malika,
when we are Malika, Shosholoza, Tae Zondaba.
Members of the family of Sir James Goldsmith, Dr. Kissinger and Mrs. Kissinger, Ms. Aspinall and Lady Aspinall, dear friends, ladies and gentlemen, I feel that our coming together on this occasion as friends of our beloved Jimmy highlights something special about the quintessence of Sir James Goldsmith's life experience, as we have heard. On such an occasion, one may be inclined to pay tribute to quite an exceptional life and to the memory of a man who has left behind an indelible footprint merely by mentioning only his deeds. Many newspapers and public eulogies have done that, and indeed we have had so many worthy eulogies to this great man today. I'm sure that the life and work of Sir James Goldsmith will become the object of academic and historical research and memory. In fact, I feel that along with his memory, we also share something that perhaps drives us in our endeavors as business or political leaders who have been charged with the difficult responsibility, an exciting challenge of charting for ourselves and for others the course of life's journey. I'm reminded of a short novel which Goethe titled Elective Affinities, describing the alchemy which brings exceptional people together from different backgrounds to share an intangible and indescribable, yet very real, commonality. Goethe borrowed this expression from chemistry, of course, to signify the destined necessity which brings different elements together to form a compound, which exceeds the original value and purpose of its component elements, as oxygen and hydrogen would do, irrespective as they form water. Undoubtedly, it is too early to assess the value of the chemistry which, say, James Goldsmith catalyzed with his boundless energy, charismatic personality, and unmistakable individuality. However, I'm sure that what he has left in all of us will continue to grow. He taught many of us the value of individual responsibility and the excitement of individual challenges, placed within a framework of deeply felt awareness for the totality of the human experience and our unity with the remainder of the natural order. Personally, I feel that my own awareness of who I am has been enhanced by the dialogue which for many years I have maintained not only with Jimmy, but also with the many friends that we shared, many of whom are today, and one of whom has just introduced me to you. Often I've discovered that his friends and I also have something in common. On this occasion, we also were also reminded of some of those friends who have passed away, such as Sir Lawrence van der Post, for instance. It was perhaps because of this elective affinity that when I first met with him in the early 80s in his flat in Paris, when I was a guest of the mayor then of Paris, Jacques Chirac, we instantaneously became friends, almost as if we had recognized one another. With the benefit of hindsight, one can rationalize this initial feeling, of course, and yet its true complexity escapes me and will remain the object of my reflection for many years to come. Perhaps I immediately admired the fact that Jimmy was not only a free thinker, but indeed also an original thinker. Since then, in my long dialogue with him, I've always enjoyed the refreshing energy of his free thought, which has inspired and comforted me during the many political fights and the long campaign of personal vilification I've had to endure in my life. As I now continue my dialogue with Jimmy, within the confines of my soul and mind, I know that his thoughts will continue to give me courage and inspiration. In over 40 years of political life, I've seldom met people who really had the courage of their own convictions, as well as the intellectual and spiritual power to develop convictions of their own rather than borrowing them from the ever-following magma of prevailing opinion trends in society. Jimmy could recognize right and wrong by himself, which may account for the fact that he never jumped to any bandwagon, but in fact, he created many bandwagons for others to jump on. I've had the direct experience of this quality of his as I witnessed him clearly analyzing the political events of my own country, South Africa. He had a better understanding of South Africa's politics than many of the world's departments of foreign affairs and think tanks, merely because Jimmy had the courage to base his own thinking on facts rather than on policies or fashionable images. He was not one who was guided by any current political correctness in his thinking or in his views. Even if he was an original and a free thinker, Jimmy did not have the character flaws which at times curse those innovators who are prone to inconsistency. Indeed, the life of experience of Sir John Goldsmith is a standing monument to consistency and loyalty. He remained loyal to his friends, to his endeavors, to his ideas, but most of all, throughout his life, he remained loyal to himself. In this respect, he made true Nietzsche's statement that the measure of a man's ultimate morality is his capacity to fulfill promises to himself. As a friend of his, I shall always bear testimony to his enduring loyalty to the cause of truth, to the cause of freedom and democracy in South Africa, and his continuing friendship to me, even when throughout the Western world, a monumental campaign of misinformation was mounted to cover the crimes committed in South Africa during the armed struggle and to vilify me and my friends. Having been a friend of Sir James Goldsmith will remain for me one of the greatest privileges of my life. I'm sure that the memory of his exuberant energy and much larger than life personality and vision will continue to impress upon me until my own life ends. I do not believe that even Jimmy's untimely death can terminate my dialogue with him, which I'm sure all his friends gathered here today will continue to nourish as his memory and spirit walk with us on the different paths of our respective lives. My thoughts and affection will always remain with Jimmy's families and children, who together carry the legacy of Jimmy's exceptional life. I know that nothing would be able to fill the vacuum opened in their lives by his untimely death, but I hope that they will always know that all Jimmy's friends will remain as an enlarged family, as it were, on which Jimmy's own families may always rely. It is sad to see a great tree, as we say in my culture, and I wish so many found shelter for. But we're gathered here to celebrate a life, a great life. To me, knowing Jimmy has certainly been one of the blessings of my own life, and I thank God for giving us such a great human being as a friend. And I feel that perhaps no adequate tribute can be paid to a life which has exceeded any horizon and has constantly been raised above and beyond any set reference previously circumscribing it. His life remains an everlasting tribute to itself and a permanent indictment of the spiritual and intellectual mediocrity of whoever dares not to rise above certain paradigms and limiting horizons. As my memory locks on Jimmy's confident smile and those penetrating eyes, the only tribute surfacing in my mind, fellow celebrants, is the voice of the spirit of the world, which in sorrow for the death of such a great man, and with disguised discomfort for all human shortcomings, murmurs, there was a true man.